Welcome into another special episode of the David Hookstead Show. Today, we are joined by former Navy SEAL Rob O'Neill, who is also the first ever two-time guest on the show. So a very special honor for Rob. Happy to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
I hope I get a trophy. It's going to go on the wall behind me for sure.
Oh, absolutely. We'll send one in the mail. So right off the bat, I've been listening to a bunch of interviews you've been doing. I've been following your Twitter feed. If you're not following Rob, make sure to follow him on Twitter. It's absolutely hysterical and outstanding. But you've been talking a lot about what's going on in Ukraine. And if you were in charge right now, what would you be doing differently than what we're seeing play out on the ground?
Now, if I was in charge, it depends on what level, because it only goes so high. And I know that there's a lot of stuff going on that we don't know about. There's dirt everywhere in Ukraine. I mean, one of the things that bothers me is people are trying to pretend that Ukraine is a democracy, which it's not. Zelensky's doing a hell of a job here, but he's corrupt as shit everywhere else. Putin's a scumbag. We all know that. But what do they all know that we don't know? Because if you think about it, we agree, because we're so blindsided by one thing. Fauci this, mask that. Oh, look, Ukraine over here. No more Fauci. All that bullshit. Putin's an asshole, but he's also negotiating our deal, our nuke deal with the Iranians. We're still buying his oil. So, right. And like you got the left that always talks about neo-Nazis. The worst neo-Nazis are the Iranians, and we're going to give them nuclear weapons, and Putin's going to negotiate it for us. And we're funding him by buying his oil. So, at what level? If I was the president of the United States, or if I was a general, what do you think?
If you were if you were in control of any military response, we'll go with that. If you were going to be the guy who had to drop, do we take out that convoy? They say they got that 40-mile-long convoy. Is that something you would take out right now if you could?
Well, at first, it would have been no, because I wasn't sure. Well, I mean, now let's not pretend I'm the smartest guy in the world. I said that they would never invade Ukraine, because I like to base a lot of my decisions on logic, and it turns out they're not logical. Invading Ukraine is about the worst thing you can do. It's a question of why. If we start to engage the Russians, that means that then they can step it up and go nuclear, which, again, I would say he wouldn't do, but he has his finger on the pulse, and they're about 10 minutes away from launch. As a military, I would try to use the back channels as much as I could, not talking to Putin, but talking to some of his generals. If I was at that high level of the military, I would have people in both Ukraine and Russia. I would try to get someone near Putin to talk some sense into him, because he's getting to a point where eventually, because here's something else you might not know. Those guys that are fighting, they start drinking around noon. The vodka's flowing. I've been to Ukraine. I've trained with the Ukrainian Spetsnaz, and it's no kidding. So eventually something's going to go errant. Something's going to hit one of the NATO countries. And when that happens, the gloves are off. I would try to tell some of my counterparts on both sides that we could wipe out those convoys in about 4 hours, depending on whether or not I had Apaches or A-10s or both. And whatever you have, we can shoot it down. We don't need to get to the only way to stop a nuclear type war is you don't match them. You got to beat them. So right. You got to let them know that we have more than you, better than you. And by the way, the Russians have proven that they suck. Like, they've been this big 10-foot bear, and now they're trying to get the rats in the corner, which are the Chechens. They don't know what they're doing. Their guys can't fight. They don't know how to fight. They don't even know how to logistically supply themselves. I would remind them that. And, we do have smart intel people out there. I'd let them know that. But if we thought there was a nuclear threat, even what they call one of the tactical nukes, we'll hit them first. And we need to decapitate the Kremlin with a nuke. It sucked. I don't like the way nuclear is getting thrown around, but this day and age, you got to meet force with force at the point of origin.
Right. Meet force with force, the point of origin. To the point you just said, though, about how poorly the Russians have kind of underperformed expectations. Has that absolutely shocked you? Because like you kind of just said, this 10-foot bear, we've all been led to believe forever that Russia is, they can go toe-to-toe with anyone, that this mighty military. And really, at least on the ground aspect, it seems like they've run into problem after problem after problem. What's your reaction to that?
They've always been like that. At the Battle of Stalingrad in World War II, the Battle of Berlin, they've been like that. They can't even support their own troops. And they're to the point where, it's like, hey, take two soldiers, give them one gun. When the guy next to you dies, grab his gun. If you turn this way, right, we'll shoot you. And they're going to do they don't know. They don't know what they're doing. They don't brute force, and they don't like life. So they'll surround a country like they're doing right now. They'll bomb the hell out of it, kill everybody, tell people they can leave. When they leave, they kill them. There's collateral damage in every war, but the Russians do not care. And what's scary about this is a lot of people that, speaking of Twitter, they make it a talking point and they make left or right. You got to humanize the soldiers. So the Ukrainians didn't want to fight at first. They don't want to fight the Russians. The Russians don't know why they're there. But as they start to figure it out and engage each other, then it becomes into revenge. It becomes into man on man. It's like, well, I saw you do this to these kids. I'm going to, like, we saw, there was a, I don't know if this has been out there because I think it got deleted. There was a senior Russian doctor saying we're treating these POWs, meaning the Russians, by castrating them.
I saw that. I don't know if that's true, but I did see that. Yeah.
It was verified by the doctor.
Oh, well, there you go.
But again, too, we don't even know what's happening over there. I've heard stuff. So, I mean, we had intel analysts way smarter than me. I was smart enough to carry a gun and a sledgehammer, but we have people out there analyzing every bit of footage. And I've heard things that even when Zelensky is talking, they're looking at the electrical outlets behind him, and they don't use those kind in Kiev. So where is he really? And so, I mean, I haven't been to Ukraine. My friend Dakota has, who I wrote the book with, and he says it's real and he's seen atrocities there that we wouldn't believe. But I mean, none of us really have been there. We don't know what the hell's going on. Why? I think it's a lot more complex than we believe. But I mean, after seeing the stuff that I've seen in the Navy and seeing what happens now, having worked with a lot of people high into Congress, you know, it's pretty coincidental that, you know, Hunter Biden's laptop comes out and is verified right as as a war in Ukraine starts. What's going on there? I mean, there was a lot of powerful people involved with a lot of offshore stuff that, I mean, even Zelensky's apparently he's got a nice yacht in Miami. And as a politician in Ukraine. You know.
Yeah, no, I get your point. To be honest, I saw the Hunter Biden stuff. That's been a story that I believe the Daily Caller even was ahead on, way in front of everyone else, if memory serves me correctly. But I don't know if you saw this, but Lindsey Graham and others, I believe, have called for the assassination of Putin, if possible. Now, you have great expertise when it comes to special forces. You're a former DEVGRU guy, famous for the bin Laden raid. In your opinion, if the U.S., do we have the capability to send guys into Moscow and take out a guy as heavily guarded as Putin?
That's a pipe dream that guys like Lindsey Graham like to put on makeup and smile and get ratings on different news channels. That's it. As a sitting senator, you don't say that on live television. As other sitting senators say nuclear war, you don't say that on television. They're in fantasy world. As a senator, maybe, like I was saying, he could talk to some of his counterparts and do a Vladimir Putin poison your enemy type thing, but you don't say it on TV. That's ridiculous. Right. As far as sending dudes in, you know, this a lot of these people that are out there that are really, really good at Call of Duty, and then they go over to Ukraine because they're calling for them, they're finding out a harsh reality when they get there. So the way you decapitate someone like Putin is you got to hit them with airstrikes. Just because, again, you know, I mean, okay, they don't fight as well as we thought. But again, you know, the Kremlin is not a three-story house in Abbottabad, Pakistan either. And right. At the dead of the night, and they have radar, they have technology. I just disagree with the way they fight because they take the easy way because they don't really care. They're not the good guys. They don't give a shit if they kill the wrong people.
Well, it's funny you brought up Call of
Duty. We're not doing that.
It's funny you brought up Call of Duty because I have a question that references something in your book, The Way Forward, which you're going to get into in a second here about kind of the fake tough guys on social media. Last thing on the Ukraine front, or two last things on the Ukraine front. The Biden administration was reported as being prepared to send in a rescue mission to get Zelensky if it looks like the end is near. Now, from what I'm going to throw out the scenario to you. You tell me if it's realistic. In order to get Zelensky, are we going to have to fly in helicopters, stealth Blackhawks from Poland, land him in Kyiv, snatch this guy in the middle of the night and just essentially fly our way out and hope that we don't get in a shootout with Russians on the ground? I mean, how does something like that work, rescuing something from a city that's completely cut off and surrounded potentially?
I mean, if you're going to take helo operations, you got to go with a guerrilla package. You got to bring all kinds of gunships and everything. And you got to think about the defense with their, a MiG's not the greatest jet in the world, but a jet versus a helicopter, the jet's going to usually win. You know, if we were going to do some sort of a tier one type mission, I think it'd be hide in plain sight type. There's a road that goes from Poland across to I think Kyiv and then in Kiev. And I think, you know, if you coordinate a meet quietly, I think the best way to do it would be the same way that we rescue journalists, people that have been hurt, the same way we pull people out, which we have veterans over there doing it now. I mean, you know, we do have men and women. I'm not going to get into too many tactics, but we have the capability. Right. I don't think it'd be, you know, flying in, you know, with eight Chinooks and then a bunch of Blackhawks. And I mean, you know, something with a high-end air-to-air type aircraft that can't be seen in case something engages you, shoot them down, convince them not to, or just lock them up or whatever. The quiet way is usually the best. I mean, like even in Afghanistan, it was better to drive around in the daytime in a van that was not armored, as opposed to driving in a big black armored Suburban that only Americans would drive.
Right. You try not to draw attention. So yeah, like I said,
like they always would say, well, why'd you grow a big red beard? I mean, you're not going to blend in. I'm like, I am from 100 meters.
That's a very fair point. Didn't even think about that. So like I mentioned, Rob and Dakota Meyer, see it on screen right here, The Way Forward. I read it in 2 days. Awesome. I couldn't put it down. I thought it was absolutely outstanding. Thank you. One of the things, and I encourage you all, you can get it virtually anywhere books are sold, I assume, right? Is that correct, Rob?
Yeah, you can get it anywhere. And the one I'd recommend, I mean, buying a book's great. The feel of a book and being able to go back and stuff is great. But we both did read the audio. And so you get to hear us tell our stories. And there's stories in there. I was just talking on social media recently about the story that was not, like, I've been on a lot of missions that people have questioned how it really happened. I had someone question me about chapter 12, which is the hunting chapter, when shit went sideways with the deer and we had the Boston police there, and there was drinks and marijuana and stuff involved in the porch camouflage. Anyway, the point is we read that, so you can get it anywhere, and it's a hell of a read. I wasn't in the Navy, by the way, so if you know.
Oh yeah, no. You're a former Navy SEAL. That's how famous for a specific mission in Pakistan, which we've talked about on this show at length. One of the things that really stood out to me in the book is when you kind of decide to be a Navy SEAL, people back home where you were working at the time, they didn't really seem to believe in you. They didn't think it was possible you could do it. How much did the criticism and the doubters and the naysayers motivate you when things would get real, real hard on that journey?
That's when the motivation came in, is I had an instructor tell me during the hardest times, well, right before the hardest times were about to start, he said, you're about to go to war and the enemy is all your doubts, all your fears, and everyone you know back home that told you you weren't good enough to do this. And so you kind of keep that in mind. You don't let it drive you. And what I've learned in 46 years of life is that you're only accountable to yourself. And that's good advice. You know, fuck that guy. But if you need the motivation for someone that said you couldn't, that's the best motivation. So yeah, they didn't believe it. And that's Butte, Montana is a small town, but everyone's from somewhere. We all have that in common. And some people are afraid of success and they're afraid to leave. They can be big, tough guys, but they don't want to leave the town because someone might be better. And that was just one of the things. I was working in a mine, and Butte, Montana is a tough town. Some guys told me that I couldn't do it. I didn't think I could do it, but I knew I wouldn't quit. And so you need to find some motive. And people will say, well, how often did you think of quitting? I was like, pretty much every other minute.
Well, and it's real quick. I've been to Butte a small handful of times, because when I lived in Bozeman, I would sometimes fly into Butte and then drive back to Bozeman. So Butte, I haven't stayed there long enough to really get to know it at all, but no, it is, I respect anyone who lives in Montana. Montana is a great state. It's if you've never been, spot. You should be. So speaking about not quitting when things get tough, so you're in the water at one point and they bring you into a room, you're really cold. You talk about this in the book. And a guy urinates on your hands to warm him up. Am I getting that correct?
I asked him to, because, this is when I realized that misery loves company and the worst situations bring out the best humor. And if you can laugh at stuff, it's going to help you out. So every day, at least once a day during Hell Week, which is a 6-day evolution where you don't sleep, at least once a day, they would bring you to medical. They clean you off with fresh, cold water. The docs check you out, check your eyes, see how you're doing, take your temperature. And then when you get done, you get it's a fresh change of clothes, everything from your skivvies, socks, boots, camis, or not camis. We wore greens at the time because it was hard when I went through. But as soon as you get dressed, they throw you back in. You're going to go right. You're not going to stay dry. So I was trying to tie my boots, and it was maybe Wednesday, and we've been awake for a while. My hands are all chafed up and just freezing. And I looked at a buddy, and I think it's the first time I ever talked to him. And I said, hey man, can you pee on my hands? And I meant to warm them up to tie my boots. And he looked at me shivering, and he looked at me, he goes, yeah, I can. If you're into that. And I'm like, why would I be? I get it. That's funny.
A little bit of humor. Yeah.
But humor going, man, if you can keep morale up, your team's going to be a lot better than nobody wants to. I mean, it's okay to bitch, but nobody wants to hear a whiner.
Right. And there's a big difference there. There's a big difference between those.
It's like two. The difference between quitting and failing. like failing, you can try again. People learn from failing, quitting something else. They're just, you don't need to quit. You can fail.
I want to think about how to word this. When you were in Buds, in your mind, because you're like, hey, I'm not going to quit. I'm going to do this. I'm going to prove myself correct. But in your mind, would it have been embarrassing for you to just punch out and say, fuck this, I'm going home?
Yeah, it would have been. It just wasn't in my nature. Too many people had said no. And then too many people just thought it was too hard. And I don't mean just people back home. I mean, like, there were guys that would talk to Big Game, but then they're just afraid of it. And it's sort of a realization, and this works everywhere, that wherever you are, you're going to get used to it.
Right.
It can suck, but you get used to it. Like, even now when people say, well, you know, once a Navy SEAL, always a Navy SEAL. I'm like, well, no, I'm not a Navy SEAL. I was, you know, I was a high school student. I don't call myself a high school student. And it's always that you have that, like when you graduate high school, for example, you have that one day where you're the king of the world. Guess what? Next day, you're a freshman again, or you're bottom of the totem pole, whatever job you just took. If you're you're going to be a mechanic or whatever, you're the junior guy. You're the one making coffee and lunch. I mean, there's always something else to do. So, but you get used to it.
Would you say that going to become a SEAL, becoming a tier one guy, going through that extensive level of training, is it more the mind games that are likely to trip you up, or is it more the physicality of it? Which is the bigger hurdle you got to cross?
Well, the physical part is a huge deal, obviously, but it's the talking yourself through the shin splints, through the bad knees and the broken toes, through the back and the chafing on your head. It's the ability to talk your body through it. It's not like it's people say it's all mental. Yeah, to an extent, but it's extremely fucking physical. And it's the realization that you can talk your body into anything through your mind. But if your mind goes, you're done. If somebody get, you can tell that look in their eyes. And if they're going to quit, you're not talking them out of it. And don't even try. Don't even waste your energy on him. He's going to quit. He's going to quit. That's fine. And, you know, whatever, you quit, whatever. It's fine. You tried. You know, it wasn't in my mind to quit, but the mental part really comes during the more technical stuff, like the diving, dive medicine, dive physics, and then demolition, electrical, non-electrical. And then, I mean, then that's, you know, to be a Navy SEAL, and then the workup stuff. But then it's to get to SEAL Team 6, it's instructors purposely failing you for things you all know you didn't fail, to see how you handle it. You didn't screw up and we know it, but we punished you for it. And then the question is, can you get over it? And they want to get in your mind. And that's, again, great shit for life. You're going to screw up. Get over it.
Right. I believe you said this in our first interview, when you talk to football teams, what is the line about second and 15? If you want to repeat that.
Second and 15, it just is.
I had never heard anyone say,
how do we move forward?
I had never heard anyone say anything like that before you said it the first time around. And I actually thought, and I've used that line in some arguments since, when I'm trying to, hey, we got to persevere.
Well, and even like, you know, I give advice on what to do now, how to get over it. And I give myself my own advice all the time, because I screw up still, and I've screwed up, and I try to learn from it. And if you hold, even if against yourself, if you hold a grudge, the only person you're affecting is yourself.
Right.
You drop that bag of bricks. And, you know, if you're wrong, apologize, learn from it, get over it. And if you don't like it, fuck you. I don't need you around. I'm accountable to myself. Take care of my family. You can beat it.
One of the other things you said in the book that really was interesting to me, and maybe you said it in other interviews too, is one of the worst things you can say is, this is the way we've always done it. So this is how we're going to do it. Can you walk me through that mindset? Because I think that applies to the corporate world, the sports world,
everything.
It applies to literally everything. So why is that mindset such a shitty thing to have?
Because everything changes. Life is fluid. And something that, well, the best example that I saw was we used to use Vietnam tactics for close quarters battles, CQB, when entering a room. And the thing was, they learned if you go in fast, you can beat him with speed. And that makes sense in the late 60s, right? The early 70s. But now we have night vision, we have lasers, and why are you going to be loud when you can be quiet? And I remember before we went to war, because I joined the Navy in 1996. I had a before 9/11, I had a young guy say, why don't we go slow? Wouldn't it make more sense? I go, no, this is the way we've always done. Saying that, and then all of a sudden, guys are getting rat lit up going into rooms fast. Like, hold up. Now let's slow down. Let's change some shit. Why, you know, why are we landing here with a loud helicopter and blowing the door? Why aren't we landing over there and walking in? And why are we blasting that thing when we can pick the lock? Why are we yelling when we can wake them up? And that was actually the most fun of war for me, was walking up on a terrorist and putting a finger on his lip and waking him up, you know, to his worst nightmare. Nothing like seeing a grown terrorist tough guy shit his pants. It's amazing.
And how many times is something like that where you were that close to him right before you either snatched him or whatever happened? How often did that happen?
We would have competitions every night to see who could do it more.
Oh, man. That is one of the most alpha things I've ever heard in my life.
And it was because I don't care who you are. If someone wakes you up and their face is glowing, you're going to need a second. Like, that's your, yeah. Like, when you wake up to something, it's like there's 3 or 4 seconds. I mean, and in their defense, because like I said, we're the good guys. We're not going to walk in there, scare them, and shoot them. Like, we're going to give them that, all right, you're going to get arrested now. I mean, right. No, but what we were doing, though, is actually, you know, you check them for bombs, because some of the guys are asleep with suicide vests.
Suicide vests on, yeah.
You're actually checking them first, and if they have a bomb, then it's, you know, hey, he's a threat, so you do what you got to do. But waking up, we got to the point where we actually had fun. Nah, fun's a bad word, because it was fun at the time when I thought, whatever. The further you get along with it, it's like, that's kind of fucked up. We're scaring the shit out of these people.
Well, hey, I mean, they're bad guys. Let's, yeah, you
some
know.
Some of them are bad guys. Sometimes it's just the wrong house.
Well, I got some questions about the comet thing, but to what you just said about the guy sleeping in suicide vests, I don't know if when they killed the head of ISIS, like, what was that, 2 months ago now? They got him, or he blew himself up. They said in the news, one of the tactics that Delta Force team did was they got on a speaker system for like 45 minutes because they didn't want to risk a suicide vest going off, which unfortunately, yeah. And people, idiots on Twitter were criticizing that. And then some people came out and were like, actually, this is really fucking smart if you don't want to risk losing a bunch of guys.
It's extremely smart. That's how Delta rolls. They're the other tier one unit. They're very, very good at what they do. They learn from the past. And, you know, the guys on Twitter, they're getting to wipe the Cheetos off their face and guts before they start back. I mean, they have the best tactics. Like, I love reading the Instagram comments. Well, if you notice here what I would have done, it's like, no, you would have shit your pants is what you would have done. And you'd be yelling for your mom hiding behind a damn wall. But no, they came up with that plan. If it's an escalation of force, if they know you're there, why are you going to rush in? Why are you in a hurry to die? Chill out. Tell them you're here. Here's what we're going to do. And that's what they did. It's called a call out. And it's smart. I mean, if we have the perimeter, which they did, and we have the air cover, we have a lot of time. There's no reason to run in there and die because we're bored. Don't ever die because you're bored.
That's another great quote. We can print that one out and put it on a poster. So how often when you're going through training and stuff, you know, you've done the same reps 20 different times. And then finally someone's like, hey guys, this is not working. We got to do something different. Is that pretty much every time you would train for something? Someone's like, hey, hand up.
Every single time. And when we debrief ourselves, meaning we get done with even training runs, then we have the range safety officers talk to everybody and I, you know, go around and talk. And I don't want to hear, don't tell me, hey, I did this and it was awesome. Tell me what you fucked up. Tell me, right. You tell me what you did. Cause we're at a level now where, yeah, what am I going to give you, a demerit or a safety chit? Just come on, tell me what you fucked up and we learn. And then you talk to the guys who just came back from Iraq and Afghanistan. What'd you see? Because Al Qaeda seeing us, Taliban seeing us, and they're adapting. So how do we readapt? What are they doing? When we enter the room, how are they posturing themselves and how do we change? So every single time you should, I mean, there's nothing wrong with what if we did this? And hey, if it's stupid, that was stupid. Let's try something else. Why is it we can't get two guys at the same time through one door? Well, how do we skydive? We managed to get 4 guys out at the same time. Well, let's, you know, just thinking outside the box. Don't revert back to, well, this is the way we always used to run through the door. So I heard an idiot say, well, we're going to get in a fight anyway. Might as well get it over with. No, that's stupid. You're an idiot. You should not be here.
Right. That's, yeah, no, don't, that, I don't even have a good response. That's insane to me.
I mean, keep it as simple as you can. We had a tactic where I might have said this last time we talked, or definitely we did over beers at the football game. Right. But we were trying to think of a way, you know, when you get people moving dynamic maneuvers through a house, it's very dangerous to enter on each other. Cause you know, what if we're here and how, and it was always the, well, don't be on fire and you can't point your gun at the same guy. Cause that's unsafe. And what if we do this and knocked on a door and then maybe we click a glow stick and put it. And I was like, hey, how about this? don't shoot someone who looks like you.
Yeah, there you go.
And I just mean someone with the same shit on.
Right. He's got the night vision, all that stuff.
So take that, you know, slow down. Because if you want to be fast anyway, slow down. Slow is smooth, smooth is fast.
So I know that you say, and you said it in other times too, and I want to dig into it a little bit because you get into specifics in the book. The burden of death is not something you would wish on anyone. And specifically when you hear people talk, it probably means they haven't done shit. And I'm wondering, what was your expectation going into your first combat? And when you look back all these years later, how different is it how you view it now compared to how you viewed it when you were a young guy first doing it?
When I first went into actual combat, I assumed that every car was going to blow up. There's suicide bombers in every closet, shooting everywhere, and everyone's a bad guy. And I actually learned a ton from my very first mission because I was looking at my boss, who was a bit shorter than me, but had a glorious beard. And just everything from, he was wearing stuff to keep him light, short sleeves, tattoos, a big beard. And I'm like ducking behind cover and I'm just wasting energy. And I looked at him and I remember thinking, I want to be cool like him. And that's kind of how I learned, just following him. And and then you get used to it. You realize what's what. And from that one to like, even my last mission, I realized that the vast majority of people, even in the combat zone, are not combatants. All they're trying to do is get on with their lives. All they're trying to do is exactly what we're trying to do. I want to meet my spouse. I want to have a family. I want to raise them. And I want to die an old man. And that's what they're like. And, they just get caught in the middle of this bullshit. Imagine in Western Iraq, you got Sunnis out there, but Al Qaeda's Sunni, and we got Americans out there. We're trying to tell the good guys that live there, hey, tell us when Al Qaeda comes here. But as soon as we leave, Al Qaeda knows who they talk to. They got to deal with Al Qaeda, and then it's a shitstorm for all of them. And they want is to get on with their lives. Most of them, some of the most generous and welcoming people into their homes I've met were in valleys in Afghanistan, where they don't live exactly like we live, but they're just generous. And I mean, most people want to get along with each other. Most people are nice. Not on Twitter, but
right. Yeah. Everyone's a tough guy behind a computer screen.
It's true.
I asked this question to a lot of military guys I interviewed, especially those who served in Iraq. And I'm curious to get your opinion on it. Do you view foreign fighters, when I mean people that came to Iraq who were not Iraqis, they weren't Iraqi military guys, they weren't uniformed soldiers, they were coming there with the sole purpose of, there are Americans here, let's kill them. Yep. Did you view them very differently from how you would have viewed Iraqi uniformed soldiers? And would you?
Oh, yeah. Most of the, I mean, that's a lot of the reason that Afghanistan calmed down. It's easier to get to Iraq. So when you're talking about foreign fighters, generally you're talking about, like I said, like the Sunnis. So from the Jordanians, the Egyptians, Saudi Arabians, the guys that traveled there to Ramadi, Fallujah, they're not there to teach anything. They're there to fight Americans. Right. And it's the easiest place to kill Americans, right? They're the jihadis, no doubt about it. And again, it's not all of them. I'm saying that because, the Sunni Shia difference, I could talk about that forever, but the Al Qaeda guys that came up and eventually turned into ISIS, other than Abu Musab al-Zarqawi, who was almost the number one terrorist, was a Jordanian that came in there. And he was the one cutting heads off and all that shit.
Were you ever on any missions that involved the hunt for him?
Yeah. Yeah. I was on a couple. I mean, we didn't see him. It was cool because this is before we'd really done. I mean, we'd fought. And we got in big fights, but it was never a top tier target. Just getting like the briefing and seeing his picture and his aliases and all that shit. It was like, oh shit, we're getting, and that was one where we're landing right on the X because I don't know why. And like landing in front of a big mosque and it was, charged up, but he wasn't there. Obviously the Delta got him with the Air Force.
Yeah. I was gonna say, didn't they drop like a 500 pound bomb on him?
They hit him with something. Yeah. Yeah. And then Delta got in there. I heard the last thing he saw was a Delta guy and an American flag or something. It was pretty, I hope it's awesome. And as far as I know, that's what happened. That's great.
That is bad.
Oh, yeah. Those guys are studs, man.
You've talked before, and I think it's really important, about how when you get complacent, it's easy to get killed. Yeah. And when you kind of lose the adrenaline. So how do you know whether it's the job you're in, the marriage you're in? How do you know, like, hey, I'm in a rut? You might be in a rut for so long, you might not even realize it. I mean, what are the triggers that are like, hey, something's got to change.
Well, you got to master the basics. And it's everything from what I was talking about, close quarters battle. I'm talking about shooting free throws. You know, get the basics down, master the basics. Don't make anything more complicated than it needs to be. And, you know, you got to, you know, figure out your long-term goal with short-term goals. And how do I get from one to the other? And then when you find yourself taking shortcuts, that's when you're getting complacent. My wife works in the power line industry. And so I work with a lot of their contractors, a lot of linemen that get up on the power lines, and a lot of the chapter managers and bosses and stuff. They're all hard hat wearers, but I'll tell them, like, when I talk about the basics and getting complacent, I'm like, you ever seen that sign that says 540 days incident free?
Yep.
That day is when someone gets blown off the power line. Because you're up there doing something, the monotony of, well, oh shit, I forgot my gloves. And it would take me so long to get down there and grab them, and so long to get back up on this pole. And it's a quarter turn on this, and that electricity doesn't care, neither does a bullet. So when you start taking shortcuts, that's when you get hurt. That's why my saying is don't die because you got bored. And unfortunately that happens. It's complacency. And complacency is caused by success. Like I said, I fuck up a lot. Like, I'll do some stuff so much, I don't take it serious. Public speaking, you know, I've done 700 of these, but this is the first time this company hired me. I don't take it serious, don't give a good performance. And that's what they remember. Do everything like you do anything.
So one of the serious points that you made that I thought was very interesting, you say you don't think about the Bin Laden raid every day, which some people, maybe the fake tough guys, which is the very next question on my list, they might try to paint you as that's all you do, but you do think about one guy very often. And yeah. I thought that was very touching, because that's not something, and I don't want to spoil the book, but that's not something that I had known, but it was a very touching story. What is it about that man that the memory is just there more so than anything else?
It was one of those things where I came into a room. And now when we entered this room, I think it was in Ramadi. I know it was in Iraq. It's a big mansion style house. Like, when you come in, it's a big room with the stairwells. And I was the one man coming into the room, and I shot a guy as soon as we came in. So here's a bad guy. So it's already a hot house. So as soon as you start hearing fire, and then, you know, snipers on the roof are taking shots, you know, it's hot. And I went into some guys went to my left, and I went into a room by myself, pretty much, which you shouldn't do, but, you know, complacency, right? And I came into a room, and there's a dude in bed with his, and he's got his wife next to him, and he's sort of waking up. And I went over to kind of wake him up, and he threw some kicks and stuff at me. And, I gave him the courtesy, calm down type shit. And he had there's an AK-47 right next to him. And it almost came to, we're looking at each other, and it very close. And it's almost like, don't do it. Just don't do it, man. Don't. And he went for it. I had to kill him. And then his wife saw it, and she screamed, obviously, because she's sleeping with her husband now. He's disgusting. I mean, that's another thing too, with the guy saying, yeah, I like to kick doors and shoot fuckers in the, no, you don't. You don't know what it's like. But at the time, it's like, yeah, I got another one. But then as the time goes on, you're starting to think, okay, I'm the asshole in his room. Does he have a gun to protect his family? And then you start thinking, I don't even know that dude. He didn't know me. I met him for a second. And the only reason that we're going to fight now, other than me being in his room, is we were born on different sides of the planet. Then you start to think, what if we had met somewhere else? Like, if we met in a coffee shop in Paris, and he spoke English, or we both spoke French, would we have exchanged a joke? I mean, I don't know him. He doesn't know me. And it's like, and then the more you get into it, you start thinking, what now? His family thinks about him every day. And that's because of me, you know, and that's where your mind starts going. And that's just, you know, that's what makes you question everything. And even right now, when we talked at the beginning about if you were in charge, it's like, in charge of what? Because if you look back at Iraq, wow. Huh. What the fuck was that all about?
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, they cooked up a story because basically a guy was pissed at another guy because this guy tried to kill his father. And then we invaded and we killed 100,000 people.
Do you think that they never believed truly that there were WMDs in Iraq? Or do you think they just believed really bad intelligence?
I think that we were so amped up because of 9/11 that we're going to buy anything.
Right.
And there was such a grudge there with Saddam Hussein that we didn't take him. I was a brand new. I was a young Navy SEAL. I'm like, yeah, there's definitely WMDs. Let's get in there. Let's get the Marines in there. Let's invade. And I wanted to invade. And then I remember thinking, well, don't take your time, because I'm about to deploy. I don't want to miss it. And it's like, just take your time. Make sure, try to be right. They didn't give a shit if they were right. I mean, even with the leaving Afghanistan, how many billions of dollars worth of gear did we leave there for no reason? You know, and you're wondering.
And 13 dead service members too.
I don't even talk about them anymore, do they?
No, and that's really.
That was preventable and predictable. And they didn't give a shit.
And what when you look back at the withdrawal of Afghanistan, in your mind, what are you like? This is the one thing we could have done differently that could have made this. And maybe there's not just one thing.
There's one thing. You leave Bagram open.
Yeah, don't leave the air base. Yeah.
I mean, you got a direct flight from Ramstein, whatever you say it, right into Bagram. It's like you go, okay, go to Europe, go. And it's not like Bagram is a war zone. Let's be honest. We got green bean coffee. We got Burger King and karaoke night. So you can defend yourself. You can still help the population. You got a land-based aircraft carrier. If camps show up, you bomb them, come back in, the pilot's singing karaoke. I mean, it's not that hard, but because politicians, if you ever want to lose anything, get politicians involved and get a couple lawyers, you'll lose. And they see it as, you know, the blinders are on. Boy, if we can have everyone out of there by the 20th anniversary of 9/11, we won the war.
And wasn't that the dumbest fucking thing ever? We have to leave before the 20th.
If you took the bin Laden team and all the intel analysts and the pilots that planned the bin Laden raid and said, okay, plan the worst possible way to get out of Afghanistan, the worst plan, we would have come up with that plan.
That doesn't shock me at all. I mean, it was, and the thing is, that blows my mind as an observer, is the Biden administration and others were like, oh, it could take 6 months. For 4 to 6 months for Kabul to fall. No, took about 72 hours, actually.
Ask anyone. Don't ask the four-star general. Ask the E5 on the ground. That's who you should be talking to. And that's just, it's not that they're bad people in charge. It's a product of, we'd love to teach to lead, but we don't teach how to win. We love the structure, right. But how do we win this thing? And so the issue is, it gets so political to a certain level that a junior, not just a junior officer, but even an enlisted guy, doesn't want to tell the senior the truth because he might not get his job because this guy doesn't like what he hears, and so on and so forth. Then you get to the flag level, meaning a one-star general or admiral. It's all political. It's all political, and you can't upset the congressman. Don't tell them the wrong thing. And I'm a big believer with the military that if someone else is carrying your bags for you, you should be out.
Yeah, and I think you might even mention that in the book. As an adult man, that's got to be humiliating to have another adult man carry your shit around. Yeah. I mean, how are you not embarrassed?
Have a dude with your computer and a guy with your stuff and making your bed and give me some. No, I got my own coffee. I'm good.
Yeah,
But it gets to that. And even like, look at the officers a lot of the senior officers at the Pentagon and in D.C. and they take no responsibility. There's no accountability. They're just worried about when are they going to work for Lockheed Martin.
Well, let's not forget, Milley is trying to figure out why white people are so racist. That's what he told Congress. That's what he told Congress after Afghanistan fell apart. Yeah, I mean,
that's what they were talking about. I don't know what white rage is, but I want to learn about it. It's like, you know what? Why is it that China spends about 20% of what we spend and they have probably a better Navy now? Because they don't waste their time on bullshit. Right. And I mean, look, it's not that there's anything. I love everyone. Whatever you want to do with your life, do it. That's awesome. I'm not here to judge anyone. You be happy. But when I was in the military, no, we didn't care. It's like, right. Okay, I remember when I was getting out, the big thing was don't ask, don't tell. That was the big thing to repeal that. And they're making a big, obviously the media loves it because anything the media can do, they love it. And I'm sitting in Afghanistan after the bin Laden raid, months after, looking at these guys, knowing at least three of my guys are gay. And I'm like, do any of you guys give a shit?
No.
Can you do that? If I get shot in my gear, can you carry me out? Yes. Have at whatever the fuck else you do. We're good.
Right.
And they make a big thing out of it. And then they're forcing all this training on people that don't need it. Because it looks good for them politically or whatever.
Right.
And they're wasting. So, I mean, the redundancy too of this nonstop. All the training on what to do that don't say that. Fine. That's great. But can you shoot?
Right. Can you kill the bad guys when the time comes to it?
Carry your buddy. Yeah.
So speaking of the fake tough guys, and I've asked this question in a few interviews with people, how easy, it's a two-parter. The first one is, when you see stuff on social media, how easy is it for you to tell, okay, that guy's full of shit. Like that guy's completely full of shit when he's promoting himself as a grade A badass or whatever it might be.
I mean, there are legit combat vets with like clothing companies and teach tactics and stuff. And you can tell who they are because they have that, they have a, that dark, dark, there's a very dark sense of humor. So it's more of a, like the, hey, Carl jokes or someone chucking a grenade and says, I just joined to, for college money, like legit guys. But when you start getting, like I was saying with the whole, you know, like you see the guy at Target with the, lead or follow, get the hell out of the way. It's like, dude, what are you, what's going to happen at Target?
Right.
Avenge me. It's like, dude, fuck you. it's easy to tell. I mean, like the, when like I can tell actual combat vets, like when they yell at me and the, I read the comments too. I don't know why I can tell when actual dudes are yelling at me that they've been drinking a little, because it's funny, but it can get really mean too. And like, you can sort of tell the legit guy. And what's cool is they usually apologize. Yeah, I was drinking. It's like, dude, comments, you're fine. No worries.
When you,
it's just the guy, a lot of people that just really, I don't know what it is. They just, I don't know what the glamour is with it. Whoever glamorizes actual combat, they've never seen it. Like one of the best stories I have was, we had just finished a gunfight in Kandahar. We came back to the base. And so we're with Rangers. We got some SEALs there, and God bless them. Everyone's got there. You raise your right hand. You're there. You're part of the machine. But like, you're being the chow hall. The sun's coming up. It's breakfast. We're all dirty. And then you get the people that come in that are clean as whistles. The guys that bought up all the Maxim magazines and shit at the PX. And like, you hear the sirens go off for artillery, and all these dudes that have never been on base jump under these picnic tables, and everyone else kind of sitting there looking at them. It's like, guys, we're surrounded by HESCOs. However, the roof is it's made out of cloth. If one gets through here, the picnic table is not going to help. Sit up and enjoy your Salisbury steak.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's just you can just tell the guys that glorify the blood and guts and all that shit. I mean, most vets don't. You know.
And so, does it annoy you? Does it upset you? Like,
no,
what?
No. I mean, it doesn't. No, it doesn't annoy me.
Okay.
It's no. I mean, it's even. No, I'm just, be proud of what you've done. Don't try to be proud of something you haven't.
So you told a story in the book that's quite good, because I heard a very similar story. I was interviewing a former Delta Force guy by the name of Brad Thomas. So Brad, if you're watching, I hope you're enjoying it. And I asked him, like, what was Afghanistan like compared to reality? And he said one of the things, he's like, well, you know, I kind of thought we were going over there to fight a war. And next thing I know, you got speed limits. You got to wear a reflective vest on the base. And you tell a similar story about how some guy tried to write you a ticket, right, for not having your reflective vest on. What is up with these stupid rules?
That's what happens when you put too many people there that don't have any responsibility to start making responsibility so they can make themselves seem important. It's like, why is the Pentagon still there? What was that for World War II? Do we need that? I mean, you had three-star generals that don't have parking spots. I mean, what are you all doing here? No, so they pave the roads, speed limits, reflective belts were huge. Always, you know, always carry a gun everywhere with you, but it can't be loaded. Like, you can't have any ammo. Just dumb shit. I mean, when you get people in charge that, a lot of the people that are in charge were bullied a lot, and now they have any kind of responsibility. Like, God help you if you meet a weakling at a gate guard, that's guarding a gate to get on a bay. Oh, he doesn't have to let you on, and he can say no. People that are weak love to say no, even though I think no is a complete sentence. Just to say no is bullshit.
Right.
So yeah, I mean, the speed. I think it was like a 12-mile-an-hour speed limit, not even 15 or 7, something stupid like that. I don't know. Yeah, it got ridiculous. That's why I was saying keep bogging them open. I mean, the jets are still real. The pilots are still legit, and they can defend the borders. Why are you going to give all that shit to the Taliban?
I just, when you told that reflective vest story, I literally made a note of it, because I'm like, I just heard another guy bitch about this 3 weeks ago or whatever it was. And it is, that to me blows.
He wrote me a ticket.
And then he ripped it.
Well, yeah. I said, well, where do I pay this? And he said, well, you don't pay it. You just get it. So I get a free ticket for not wearing a belt. And he goes, yeah. And I go, here, write me another ticket for littering.
That's unbelievable. I mean, that to me is... last thing on the whole Afghanistan debacle and just kind of that whole theater war. I remember when the over, and I was watching a lot of news for a news company, you had a weird number of people on TV and on Twitter, like verified people, trying to essentially argue, you know, this is, the Taliban's not that bad. You know, they're not that bad, and we're not that good. And I'm curious, as a guy who was over there for a long time, when you hear people sympathize and or make excuses for the Taliban or other terrorist networks, and they claim that America's not really all that different. What do you think about that?
Yeah, that's bullshit. The Taliban are some bad dudes. They're vicious. They're as bad as it gets. I mean, they're not, you know, ISIS was dumb because they filmed everything and proved that they would do it. Taliban is pretty much just as bad as them. Having said that, we should have been smart enough to realize we're going to have to negotiate with them eventually. But they are kind of like, I don't personally, again, I've been wrong. I personally don't think we're ever going to hear from the Taliban again. They don't want to come here. Their interest is Afghanistan and the valleys and the opium trade and all that shit. I think we could have negotiated our way out with them, just the agreement with, you don't host these fuckers or we're going to come back. I've had Taliban guys say that to me. Like, we would meet with them. I've eaten rice out of the same bowl with our bare hands, which is crazy.
That's nuts.
Yeah, they even said shit. If we knew you were serious, we would have just given you Bin Laden. We didn't know you were going to come in with all those bombs, because they had it won up until the up in the north. But I mean, they were going to take it anyway. And I realized that we had our part won in 2005. Just keep a base for cross border ops. We'll find Bin Laden eventually, Zawahiri eventually. But yeah, I mean, they're still there. It's like, we didn't really prove much, but if we were smart and did any kind of critical thinking, we could have saved a lot of national treasure.
Yeah, no question about that. And that's what makes it so sad. I did like how, I don't think your politics probably mesh very well with Obama's or Biden's. I think anyone who follows you on Twitter is well aware of that. But you did have high praise for Obama in, as a person when you met him at, what was it, Fort Campbell? You thought he was a badass dude.
I have praise for Biden too, President Biden.
Right.
I bullshitted with him for a little bit. And everyone was in a good mood. And it was politics aside. I mean, Barack Obama, I don't care who you are, that's a cool dude. Like, you can't not say he's not cool. I mean, we're going to disagree on quite a few things. But the two times I was directly involved with President Obama was the rescue of Captain Phillips, which he authorized, which was, what, 3 months after he got into office, which is pretty kick-ass that he made that decision. And then Bin Laden, right? And he even pumped up the numbers for us for the Bin Laden raid, and he made the call. So
what do you mean pumped up the numbers?
Well, we were going to go in with two helicopters with a certain amount of fuel, with a certain amount of time on the ground, and then try to fly out. And hopefully we can make it back across the border, or we're going to run, because, you know, you don't have fueling stops.
Right. Yeah, right. Right. Exactly.
And we had a plan, like, we're going to hard point. This is the story I got. It's in my first book, The Operator. I wasn't in the room, but because all of a sudden we had these two helicopters, and we said, well, we're going to hard point, because the first people on site are not going to be the Pakistan military. It's going to be the Pak police, the locals. And we're not fighting with these dudes. We're not at war with them. And we're sort of here without them knowing it. So if you could send someone in to negotiate with the powers that be, maybe we can get out. And I guess the president said, yeah, that's interesting. And he looked at the chief of staff of the Air Force and said, what do you need hell to rain on? What do you need to rain hell on Pakistan? My guys aren't surrendering to anybody. And that's all of a sudden we got beefed up. And it's like, you know what? I disagree with Southside Chicago politics, except for right now, because he's ready to go down.
Right.
So it's like that. I mean, the politics suck. And I think that the big machine, the swamp, stuff gets bogged down. A lot of people are just trying to do the right thing. And a lot of them are trying to sabotage the country because they hate it, not people in Congress. President Obama was just, bad calls, good calls. But I mean, same with Donald Trump, and I know him. Bad calls, good calls. I've agreed with a bunch of shit he said, whatever. And I don't think anyone should ever be in a room where everyone agrees with you.
Oh, how fun is that? That's going to be boring as shit. You're just going to be in an echo chamber. You should want to engage with people.
Yeah, yeah.
Is it now? Did you ever find out what did you give Obama? Was it the American flag in a case?
He had a flag that one of the guys carried on the mission.
Got it.
And everybody signed the back of it, and so we put it in a frame. And he didn't know he was getting it. And he was going to give us all awards, and he gave us a talk, and he gave us our awards, and then we presented it to him. It was a pretty cool moment when, and I might be, it's in the book, and I might be, it might be exactly what he said, but he looked at it, and every president can talk, and he was kind of at a loss for words, and he said, "Wow, what do you think of this, Mr. Vice President?" And Joe Biden said, "Well, that'll look great in your presidential museum." And he said, "No, this is going in my bedroom."
Yeah, and that was a badass line. I thought that was really neat.
Well, that was the day when I was like, finally, we did it. We breached the gap between left and right. Now we're going to be happy Americans forever.
And then that's exactly what happened. There was never a disagreement in the history of the country since then. Not again.
That was the last time anyone ever argued.
Did you ever find out if he did put it above his bed?
No, I need to find out, though. I'd love to do that. I'd like to find out.
That would be an epic. That would be an epic full circle to the story. What did you think about Secretary at the time, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, not coming to meet you and everyone else did?
You know, I've never met her, and I don't know what where. I mean, I'm assuming she's busy. Everyone else managed to make it. She wanted the mission to happen, and she even as far as the correspondence dinner on Saturday. We didn't launch on Saturday because of that dinner, and we did on Sunday. And the word was, wait, we're going to stop this mission because of a fucking dinner is the word I got that she said. And I mean, the more I've, you know, I mean, politics, yeah, we disagree. But the more I've heard some of the stuff that she said, as far as my line, like I'm not involved with all the Department of State shit and the diplomacy and whatnot, just the combat. I got around to thinking that I would never vote for Hillary Clinton, but I might just take her in a foxhole.
Ooh, that's an interesting line. That might create some headlines out there.
She's not throwing down. She's not going to throw her gun down. She's going to fight it out. As far as I know. Again, I try to give everyone the benefit of the doubt. Like I said, I've never met her.
Right. And the neat thing about you, and I think people, when they look at your Twitter, if they don't know you, they might think, oh, he's just a MAGA guy, or he just... It's whatever. That's not really true. I mean, you give credit where credit is due.
I try to say the most obvious thing. All I try to do, like, I don't give a shit if I'm on whatever station I'm on. It's the same message. I'm just telling you what I think. I mean, and right now, like, everything the left touches turns to shit. That's just what happens.
Right. And gas is what, $30 a gallon these days or something outrageous?
Putin's fault.
You talk a little bit about the sour grapes that happened in the aftermath of the bin Laden raid. And for anyone who's watching this and you want to hear Rob talk about the specifics, go back and watch the other interview. It's outstanding. His insight's incredible. But what I want to get into now is the stuff you kind of cover in the book and the interviews you've done recently. How much did it bother you at your core that there were issues within the team post the raid, and specifically there were people who weren't even there who seemed to have issues with the way it all played out afterwards?
I don't know. That's something that a lot of people that were so close, and by so close, meaning even at the team, that just didn't get it. I understand when they jumped in to rescue Jessica Buchanan after the bin Laden raid, I remember watching it on one of the intelligence feeds and almost being jealous. I'm like, why aren't we on that mission? That's how, oh, wait, we did the bin Laden raid. So, I mean, you know, people do whatever. And you know, I don't know what the motivation was. There were people that wanted to say bad shit. I don't know what the motivation was. I mean, I'm the first to admit I followed a guy up a set of stairs and went one way because he went the other. It's not like I came through the skylight like they did the movie Navy SEALs. I did what I came. The team did the team's job and that's it. I mean, and I'm the only one to get the story approved by everybody. And that's, I just think it's important to tell this is what happened. And I don't feel the need to argue it. Cause I mean, how am I going to argue something that like one of us saw, two of us saw, and one of us is dead.
So right, it's like,
it's literally like seeing something. I know it's there and someone telling you, no, it's not. It's like, okay. I'll be honest. I don't give a shit.
Do you ever feel like that it just has got, people must want to talk to you about this every day, all day. I mean, that must be the only thing.
That's the thing too, is I'll see little comments like, hi, I'm Rob O'Neill. I haven't mentioned bin Laden in 2 minutes. It's like, all right, cool. Then stop asking me about it. If you can imagine, seriously, put yourself in my shoes. Every single person that I meet every single day that recognizes me, what do you think they ask me?
What was it like to shoot bin Laden?
If no one ever asked me about it again, sweet.
Right. And I think that's important to note because, we had an opportunity to meet at that football game, and I don't know if bin Laden really came up other than I asked you that same question I just asked now. Does it ever get old? Do you ever get tired of talking about this? But so many people came up to you, and it's not like you were going around telling anyone, right? It was people were just, they wanted their moment, right? They wanted their question.
Cool. I mean, I think as Americans, as a coalition, they deserve it. And right. The reason that I still can enjoy telling it is not, I breeze over the part in bin Laden's room. I want to talk about the reason we went. I want to talk about the first Americans who fought Al-Qaeda on Flight 93 and voted to fight. Right. We did it for them. I want to talk about the people that didn't know they were going to war at the Pentagon that day. The people in the towers that made the last call, the firemen that ran up knowing they're going to die. That's why the story should live. That's why I'm happy that George Washington had a biographer with him when he crossed the Delaware to fight the Hessians. People need to know what happened. If you ever hear me tell the Bin Laden story, it's over, and then we're leaving. And then I talk about the pilots, how right. awesome they were. I talk about the intel analysts that found him. That's the important shit. I was smart enough to carry a sledgehammer and a gun.
And you, in the interview we did previously, you really heap praise on the guy that grabbed the women.
Oh, yeah.
And so again, if you haven't seen it, go back and watch it. And you did say the woman portrayed by Jessica Chastain in Zero Dark 30, like that woman is a badass in real life, right? Like she's the real deal.
She's still out there. And, you'll never know who she is, but if you're the CEO of a major company or some sort of hedge fund and you find out it's her, hire her. She'll figure it out. She's incredible.
So one of the neat things in your book is you kind of rip the VA, you and Dakota both do. Dakota is obviously the Medal of Honor winner you wrote it with. And you talk about how you kind of took an alternative path of treatment for some stuff you were struggling with. And I'm wondering if you could touch on that. And what was the motivation to try this alternative form? And do you think more people should do that?
The motivation, I'm not going to get too much into it, but it's out there if you look at psychedelics. As far as getting in your own mind and figure out what's actually going on, it helps you with the ability to recognize what the problem is. And the problem, and for me too, is usually alcohol. And that's what veterans have, because all they're going to do at the VA is feed you with pills, give you some bullshit, sit around in a group talking about how sad we all are, and then we all go drinking. And it's the more you get into it, the sadder you get, it's a depressant. And I mean, look, I've got a beer company. We drink a football game. It's awesome. But when you're by yourself in the dark with the TV off is the problem. And then that's we need to call someone. And a lot of these psychedelic, this is the way we've always done it. The VA doesn't want to look at that shit. THC, DMT, any kind of mushroom, something where you can breathe and get in yourself. And I'm not saying what I'm taking, but there's stuff out there. I know people have to go to different countries to get it when the VA could do it right here, administered by a doctor, and it works. The THC stuff's coming around. That really helps. You know,
and it changed your life, right?
Well, yeah, it totally does. And it's not a one size fits all. Like if I try THC, which I've tried, all I do is laugh a lot. But there's other stuff that can really get down to how serious is it. And I just wish people at the VA would say, well, maybe we should try this. Like, well, that's not legal. Well, who the fuck's in charge? Maybe it should be legal.
Right.
How about these guys on Capitol Hill that they don't manage to miss giving themselves a raise? Why don't you look at we don't need to be pumping pills down these guys' throats.
So, I thought that that was another thing I made a note of right away when I read the book. And there was a lot of stuff I made notes of because, again, guys, I can't recommend enough The Way Forward. It's incredible. But that really stuck out to me, number one, about how you were honest about it. And two, about how you just said, like, this took a lot of my anger away. And I think you used golf.
Some of the stuff that you can do, like the way that I describe it is like, do you think the Beatles wrote Sergeant Pepper on talent alone? Like you just expand your mind about just thinking about other stuff. And they're CEOs in Silicon Valley, the microdose different things to calm themselves down, to realize, kind of opens everything, but realize what's important. And it helps. I mean, PTSD is real and you don't need to have been to combat to feel it. A lot of people have had traumatic things happen and this just helps you breathe. And, I've used stuff and I will again. It's like the tone down some of this shit and try some of this shit. It's just, and it should be administered, should be legal in a safe place. You shouldn't have to go to Mexico to get it.
Right. And for those of you who read the book, Dakota talks a little bit about his path, doing his alternative thing too, which I do believe happened down in Mexico. Speaking of beer, now we're going to jump into some fun questions. This is how I like to close out all my interviews. Okay. If you could have a beer with anyone, who would it be and why?
Dead or alive?
Dead or alive.
I'm going to say Muhammad.
That is an answer I've never received or anything close to. Let's go. What's the logic?
Muhammad, for two reasons. I want to find out if he likes IPA or lager.
Nice.
And I want to know, what are we doing, man? What's the deal? that would be we agree to agree and we'll be nice. Let's have a drink.
And you, like you just said, you are involved with a beer company, Armed Forces Brewing. Can you tell our audience what the updates with that are?
Armed Forces Brewing Company is our beer. We were at the Army Navy game, a couple different Navy games in Annapolis. It's out of Annapolis, and it's for every branch of the armed services. We have Jarhead beer, Cat Shot, which is for pilots. We have Special Hops, which is for special operators. There's Airman Brewery, Soldier Brewery. We're coming up with some new stuff. I can't say the name of the one that I've come up with. It's good, but we're branching out from Annapolis. We're getting into some of the exchanges, moving into Texas, Florida, hopefully Pennsylvania. And we want to, like I tell the veterans, go to the Navy Exchange, Marine Corps Exchange, the PX or whatever. If they don't have it, ask them why they don't have it. They got to get it. It's delicious. And it's a veteran-owned company. It's incredible.
Well, I'm going to say two things about this. Well, I'll say a few things. The Special Hops can is the coolest beer can that's ever been created in the history of beer cans.
Thank you.
I don't know who's responsible for designing it, but that those seals with the M4s, they're in the, it is fucking incredible. But we're going to do something special here. Alan Beal, who runs the ship over at Armed Forces Brewing, he sent me a preamble. Now, this is their new one. It's closed, so I'm going to crack it open. We're going to do
Never tried it, have you?
I had one during a March Madness game when he sent it, but we're going to do this fresh right here. Here we go.
I want to hear how it is. And yeah, like we said, we got a great brewmaster, great company, veteran owned, and it's just fun. It's a fun company. We have a really good time if you check us out. Plus, you can become an owner. If you go to our website, you can become part of Armed Forces Brewing Company. And it's delicious. The Special Hops is outrageous. I've gotten in trouble because of the Special Hops. It's so good.
That is the preamble is very smooth. That's a perfect March Madness kind of beer, a football kind of beer. But to your point about Special Hops, that's borderline criminal how good Special Hops
it's so
is.
I mean, good I like IPA. It's a not a very strong, but it's strong enough, and it's tasty, and it's not too filling. I love it.
Well, hey, shout out to everyone in Armed Forces Brewing. I appreciate the beers, Alan. Preamble, I like it. And if he could have a beer with anyone, he's answered that question now too. All right. When people look at your Twitter,
yes,
how seriously or not seriously should they take it?
Don't take it too seriously. I talk on Twitter like I'm talking right now. Like, I'll give you good stuff. A lot of it's a grain of salt, and some of it I'm just turning the screws on you. And again, I'll say some shit about some liberals. I'll knock some conservatives. And it, you know, when it's all said and done, don't take anything too serious, because none of us are getting out of this alive.
Right. And shouldn't social media be fun? I mean, isn't the whole point that it'd be fun?
It was designed to be. Like, even Instagram is turning into, like, Instagram's fun, but you still get the people. Now it's like Facebook. It's like, okay, great. You're born again. Blah, blah, blah. I get it. Stop yelling about it. It's like the whole, put the thing down. Just come on. I want to see a video. I want to see quick videos of, you know,
funny shit.
I can't even describe it.
Yeah. So one of the things that I've been talking about a lot lately, or the movie that has resurfaced, is the original Red Dawn. Everyone's been talking about it since the war kicked off in Ukraine. Have you ever seen the 1984 version?
Oh my God. I've seen it probably this week. Well, you know that Charlie Sheen's my boy.
I didn't know that, but that's badass.
I have an apparel company, RJO Apparel. And Sheen and I have something we're cooking up really soon. So Red Dawn's a shit. I love it. I love Sheen. Sheen's a salt of the earth guy. But yeah, Red Dawn's awesome. Just if you haven't seen Red Dawn, I mean, not the new one.
That's garbage.
I'm talking Patrick Swayze, man. I'm talking Charlie Sheen. I'm talking C. Thomas Howell. Jennifer Grey, before the nose job. I'm talking horses and guns.
It is so good. I actually have a rule when I date a woman, and I've been in a long-term relationship now with my girlfriend, wonderful woman. But before that, they had to watch Red Dawn. And if they didn't like Red Dawn, it was lights. I mean, that was the end of the road. Yeah. But the reason I bring it up is, if something like that happened in real life in America, what percentage of Americans do you think would engage in kind of the Red Dawn activity?
30%.
That's even way more than I figured. I thought the number would be like 5%.
I mean, you got to figure who bowed down to the masks.
That's a great way of looking at it.
We were told to stay at home. I mean, I got banned from an airline for a selfie I took without a mask on a plane.
For a joke. But
but that's how serious they take it. They're very, anything with an ism behind it, you're in a lot of trouble. Like, don't, God forbid, say anything about the religion of climate change. I mean, we're going to die long of climate change regulations long before we die of climate change.
You know, the sad thing about the map, I live in Washington, D.C. Our mandates finally were lifted probably about a month ago-ish, 3 weeks ago. There's still people walking around outdoors by themselves.
I wonder about that. Are they doing it because of shame? Like, I was right. I have to have been right. Like, we're all idiots. That's it.
Well, my theory is that the people still doing it, that are still virtue signaling, they finally felt like they could be the hero during the pandemic. Like, look at me. I got my 18 shots. I have my mask on and you don't. I'm a hero and you're not. And now I don't think they want to lose like that role that they created for themselves.
Think about how ridiculous we got. There was literally cops in the NYPD going house to house, counting how many Jews were in the house. What the fuck was that?
That I remember the videos.
They said the same thing the Stasi were saying in Germany. I was just doing my job. Well, at some point you got to, that's a whole different podcast. Maybe I'll be your first free time guy.
Yeah. Hey, you're welcome back anytime you want. I love having you on. Now, one thing you and I both have in common, you're a big Yellowstone 1883 fan, right?
Oh yeah.
It's, I don't know if you can see behind me. That's a Yellowstone tumbler in the background of the set, actually.
Good show. Good show.
Here's my theory. I'm going to run it past you. Tell me if you think I'm wrong or right. The reason Yellowstone in 1883 becomes so popular is because it just focuses on being a badass show. It's just it doesn't lecture you.
No, it doesn't. I mean, I'm from Montana. I go back there. The only issue I have with Yellowstone is everyone thinks they're ripped now.
Yeah.
Everyone up in Montana. Stop dyeing your beard black. We all know the deal. But no, yeah. I think 1883... Boy, they're both awesome. I got into 1883 because I love Yellowstone.
Same.
I think 1883 is better. I'm not going to ruin anything, but.
It pains me to say this. I can understand where you're coming from. It's only been one season, so I don't want to, we have more Yellowstone.
Yeah.
But anything with Sam Elliott.
And he's how old is he? He's crushing.
I think he's about 78 or 79. Yeah, he's old, but there. I mean, anytime Sam Elliott comes on screen, you drop what you're doing and watch.
That voice. Oh, and you know what? What else too? Same creator, a mayor of Kingstown.
Great. Oh, the prison riot scene.
How do they, Taylor Sheridan is the writer's name, I believe.
Right.
Yep. How does he know so much about everything to make it so cool? And he's in the damn thing. He's the cowboy riding the damn horse.
Well, he apparently owned, I think before he got involved in Hollywood at all, a big ranch in Texas of some size. So he grew up, I think, doing ranching shit in real life.
Obviously did.
Yeah, because the show is pretty. Now, the only thing that's funny is, and I actually told this years ago, because we would do some work with people at Paramount. My dad's a veterinarian. He actually just retired, Jeff Hookstead. And there's some things in Yellowstone that apparently aren't overly accurate, but he likes the show. But he would call me about the veterinarian stuff. He's like, just so you know, that's not how it is in real life.
That's the way it is for us with action movies and TV shows. Like, I could pick it apart, but it's like, let me enjoy it. I mean, there's certain things like The Town, which is a great movie about the bank robberies. But at the end of Fenway Park, when one of the cops takes a shot with like an M4, takes one shot and then he jacks the charging handle back. Like, God damn it. You ruined the entire movie with that.
Another really good movie. Well, speaking of Hollywood here, I got a good question for you.
I got about 2 minutes. I hate to jump off.
This will be the last one. Alec Baldwin, when he shot that woman, would you, if a company came to you and said, hey, we'll pay you X amount of money to be our expert, would you do it after that?
100%. It's not that hard. I mean, why was there live ammunition and ammunition anywhere near the set? Why was the cast between scenes out plinking with the prop gun?
Right.
It's not that hard. Look, they should never, if an actor doesn't want to take the time to learn about it, you got to hand him a gun that's ready. And he, first of all, you never pull the trigger pointing it at anybody. I don't care who you are. You can design the angles to where it looks like you are. You don't do that. I mean, I grew up in Montana. I took hunter safety at like 12. The first thing they tell you is treat every gun as if it's loaded. That's the first thing you tell 12-year-olds.
Right. Well, hey, Rob, as always, it is an absolute pleasure. I appreciate you coming on. And maybe you'll be the first ever third time guest. Let's leave the door open on that.
I can arrange some special hops to get to your place and we can drink the whole time.
Hey, I would love that. All right, Rob, take it easy.
Thanks, brother.